Okay, we're live now. So welcome everyone to this Extra 2021 Virtual Congress. My name is Andrzej Kroll. I'm a consultant in anesthesia and pain medicine at St. George's Hospital, and I will be moderator of this session. And we have a distinguished speaker, Professor Kenneth Candido, and he will talk to us about interventional pain treatment and chiefly the spinal cord stimulation. Before I introduce Professor Candido, just a few technical remarks. Just use the chat to ask questions, so we will have a time to answer some of them. We'll try to make it as interactive as possible. And remember, this session will be recorded and available on the website for at least the whole year, so we can come back if you feel that you need to have a break and a coffee. And let's get started. So let me to introduce Dr. Kenneth Candido. He has been spending his professional life between New York and Chicago, and he's professor of surgery and anesthesia at the University of Illinois College of Medicine in Chicago. He has published more than 180 peer-reviewed scientific papers and abstracts, wrote about 100 textbooks, chapters with regional anesthesia, acute and chronic pain management, so perfectly fit into the ESRA profile. He's currently the chairman of pain management at the Pain Medicine Fellowship Director at Illinois Masonic Medical Center in Chicago. And for 15 years, he was the departmental chair. Off the record, I hope that Kenneth will not be upset to tell you, he's got impressive collection of Greek and Roman statues in his garden with a real size. And you can follow him on Twitter. He's very active, so you can become his follower soon. So Kenneth, how do you do in Chicago?
Good morning, Andrzej. Thank you for that very nice introduction. We're doing quite well. Winter hasn't struck yet, so we're finishing up our beautiful summer here and having a wonderful time and staying healthy and staying free of the pandemic, thank goodness. And thank you again for introducing me. Can you hear me? My topic is interventional pain management for the European Society of Regional Anesthesia 2021 virtual course, Ask the Experts. I do not have any disclosures that relate to this educational activity. However, throughout the course of my professional life, I've had some industry support for several of the ongoing clinical trials that I've been conducting throughout the past years. I'd like to talk about our learning objectives. What is new in interventional pain management? Obviously, interventional pain management encompasses a wide swath of activities and procedures primarily, as well as other treatments for the management of acute and chronic pain. But by and large, the number one development for interventional pain is the explosive use of spinal cord stimulation in the past decade or so. I'd like to talk a little bit about evidence-based medicine and the economics of interventional pain management, because we can never underestimate the effect that economics has on our selection of technologies and approaches for managing our patients' pain. This is a recent publication from this year in the journal Pain Physician, showing the trends of utilization and the expenditures for spinal cord stimulation use in the United States of America. This is based on a Medicare population, so we're primarily dealing with individuals above the age of 65 years, so it's not a full representation of all patients with chronic pain. But what we see clearly is that there's been an explosive use of spinal cord stimulation in terms of economics. In 2009, we went from a total expenditure of $292 million, US dollars, to $1.142 billion, representing a 291% increase over that decade, averaging about 16.4% annual increase. So spinal cord stimulation use has not only been increasingly seen in our patients with chronic pain, failed back surgery syndrome, and complex regional pain syndrome primarily, but the expenditures associated with this are astronomical. And if you look, this is on the left side of the screen, you'll see the number of utilization of patients both for trials and permanent implantation of generators. And in 2009, we had 45,000 patients receiving trials. In 2018, we had almost 60,000 patients. Placement of pulse generators went from about 4,000 in 2009 to 14,360. Again, in aggregate, we've had a very healthy expansion of the use of spinal cord stimulation. The top bar shows that the permanent pulse generator implants on average for 100,000 Medicare recipients is about 61, and that's about doubling what we saw in 2009. And trial stimulations has now gone to 39 out of 100,000 population from a prior number of 17. Again, more than doubling the utilization of both trials and permanent stimulation. If you look at who's performing these procedures, whether it's surgeons or interventional pain management groups, you'll see that in 2009, we had about 840 procedures by surgeons, now more than 2,380. So there's been a tripling of the use of spinal cord stimulation by surgeons, and same for interventional pain physicians. We went from about 11,000 to 33,000, representing again a tripling of the use of these devices by interventional pain physicians. So both surgeons as well as interventional pain physicians have tripled the utilization of spinal cord stimulation for things like failed back surgery syndrome and complex regional pain syndrome in the Medicare population. If you look here, the number of trials has gone up again, relatively robustly, but pulse generator implants has gone up even further. And the actual total number of procedures now has been about 291% higher in year 2018 compared to year 2009. Compared to other interventional pain procedures, which have remained relatively flat, including epidural injections and facet joint injections, we can see that neuromodulation has become a primary modality with a tripling of the utilization in the Medicare population, whereas epidural injections are actually on the decline somewhat, as are facet joint injections over the last several years. We don't understand completely why this is occurring, but in the Medicare population, it appears that there's been a reduction in utilization of epidural steroid injections and a reduction in the use of facet joint injections and radiofrequency ablations. This demonstrates the total cost for the facet injections, and you can see that the cost in 2018 is approximately the same as what it was in 2009. Facet joint injections, again, the costs have relatively been static. The number one cost that's been augmented going back from 2009 to 2018 has been a tripling or 291% increased utilization of the cost for spinal cord stimulation. This is a paper that I was privileged to participate in, recently published in the journal Pain Physician in 2021, looking at the methodology for evidence synthesis and the development of comprehensive evidence-based guidelines for interventional techniques in chronic spinal pain. And so I just demonstrated to you the number one increase has been in the utilization of spinal cord stimulation, but how do we determine whether these technologies are actually have merit or not, and whether they're safe for our patients? And so we looked at a systematic review of existing evidence, and momentarily I will define for you the difference in systematic review versus meta-analysis, for example. And the purpose of this complex assessment was to minimize distortions, minimize biases, and conflicts of interest. And we created a standard for evidence, standard one, establishing transparency, standard two, disclosure of COIs within the GDCG, standard three, guideline development group composition, standard four, clinical practice guidelines using a systematic review, standard five, evidence foundations for the rating and the strength of recommendations, and standard six, articulation of the recommendations. And so this is based upon the board of directors from the American Society of Interventional Pain Physicians, of which I am also on the board. There are 4,500 practicing interventional pain physicians, which comprise the American Society of Interventional Pain Physicians. And based upon our evidence review, we created recommendations grades. Grade A is at least one meta-analysis, systematic review, or randomized controlled trial rated as 1++. Grade B, a body of evidence which indicates studies as rated as 2++. Grade C, a body of evidence including studies rated as 2+, directly applicable to the target population and demonstrating overall consistency of results. And grade D, where evidence level is 3 or 4. And based upon this, we could determine which of our technological interventions make sense for our patients based upon efficacy and based upon safety. We looked at a guide of the strength of recommendations. Strong recommendations is where there's high confidence that the recommendation reflects the best practice of medicine. Moderate grade is where there is moderate confidence that the recommendation reflects the best practice. And this is based on good evidence, but not strong evidence. And weak evidence is that there is some confidence that the recommendation offers the best current guidelines for practice based upon limited evidence for a true net effect or consistent results, but with important exceptions. And that's how we grade the evidence for interventional pain of the spine: strong, moderate, or weak. Epidural interventions, for example, I also participated in the synthesis of this publication, Pain Physician 2021. Epidural interventions in the management of chronic spinal pain, the use of ACIP, comprehensive evidence-based guidelines. We published this a few months back in the journal Pain Physician. And what did we find? That the evidence is very strong when epidural steroid injections or epidural injections are used for disc herniations. Very strong recommendations. When it's used for thoracic injections, epidural with fluoroscopic guidance has level 2 with moderate to strong recommendations. When used for spinal stenosis, epidural injections are not as robust in terms of their evidence, now dropping down to level 2 or level 3. For epidural injections with moderate recommendations, for transforaminal use, it's level 4. So the evidence has actually dropped down a bit since our earlier iterations of these recommendations and guidelines in 2013. For discogenic pain, the level is 2 with moderate to strong recommendations using epidural injections for axial discogenic pain. And for post-surgery syndrome, failed back surgery syndrome, for lumbar and cervical, the evidence is actually quite good, level 2. For percutaneous adhesiolysis, a special interventional technique, the level of evidence is level 1 with strong recommendations for long-term improvement. And I'll go through this momentarily. As I pointed out earlier, however, it's interesting to me and interesting to our society that epidural injections, which went up in the decade of 2000-2009, as shown by the green numbers here, whether all epidurals, lumbar, interlaminar, lumbar or sacral transforaminal, cervical or thoracic, and finally cervical thoracic transforaminals. In the decade of 2000-2009, there was actually an increase up to almost 20-23% in some cases. However, in the past decade, we see an actual reduction in the utilization in the Medicare population of all these epidural injections. And it appears that while spinal cord stimulator use is on an exponential rise, the use of things like epidural steroid injections and facet joint injections and radio frequency has actually shown a modest decline in that same Medicare population. So here you can see the relatively very brief reduction or minimal reduction in cervical thoracic interlaminar epidurals. Cervical thoracic transforaminal injections are on the decline in the Medicare population in the past decade of 2009 to 2018. Again, we don't know why, because the population continues to increase in age. The baby boomers are now coming into the Medicare population range. And for lumbar, interlaminar, and transforaminal injections, we also see a relatively stable or flat ratio of the utilization of these procedures in the Medicare population. This demonstrates the procedures per 100,000 Medicare population by services. And you'll see that there's been a relatively modest decline in the overall service, as well as the visits, as well as the number of patients receiving these services in the years 2009 to 2018. So we're using less epidural injections and less facet joint injections in our Medicare-based population, typically individuals above the age of 65 in the United States. As a corollary to that, we can see another trend, which is the use of the opioid prescriptions. Of course, we're all very much cognizant and aware of the opioid epidemic. But as you can be seen by this graphic, from 2011 until the present time, 2020, we've seen about a 50% reduction in our prescription writing for opioids. So not only have our interventions been reduced in the Medicare pain population, but by a factor of almost 50%, we're actually prescribing less opioids to our patients in accordance with following guidelines for the Center for Disease Control and for looking at keeping our relatively the morphine milligram equivalents to 90 or less for our patients under most circumstances. Now, do the interventions that we provide for our patients actually show efficacy? And the data actually suggests that the number or the percentage of patients showing 50% or greater improvement is actually very stable. At 6 months, almost 75% of patients show improvement in their symptoms when they receive epidural injections or injections of the facet joints for stenosis, post-laminectomy syndrome, or pooled data. At 12 months, the numbers decline somewhat down to about 70%. But at 24 months, we can see patients who've received a series of these procedures continue to do quite well. So interventions do work. They're very cost efficient, as we'll see momentarily. And so you can see here that the cost of providing spinal surgery to our patients with spondylolisthesis averages $115,000 per patient in Medicare dollars. Degenerative spondylolisthesis surgery, the SPORT trial, shows that the costs of surgery are about $77,000 per patient. For disc herniation surgery, again, the cost is about $70,000 per patient. Physical therapy can range all the way up to $32,000 per patient per series of interventions. And then you come down to the procedures that the interventionalists perform, things like spinal cord stimulator use, lumbar facet joint injections, adhesiolysis, and epidural injections. And you can see that there's a very substantial cost-benefit ratio to the utilization and implementation of interventional therapies that reduce the patient's requirement for spinal surgery. Now, how do we use an algorithm to approach our patients with chronic pain? And that's what the American Society of Interventional Pain Physicians is actually charged with doing, looking at an algorithmic approach to managing our patients' pain. We look for the patient's pain with history, physical assessment, and looking at diagnostic studies. And then we segregate patients into chronic low back pain, somatic versus radicular, chronic neck pain, somatic versus radicular, chronic thoracic pain, somatic versus radicular. And we apply our interventions on an as-needed basis. And what do we find? Well, the first thing I wanted to mention is that there are a lot of different societies providing guidelines, and it's essential to develop clinical guidelines, which are defined as a body of evidence, which regard the safety, the efficacy, as well as the cost effectiveness of utilization. And we have found that sometimes, because the societies have different political viewpoints, that rather than being evidence-based medicine, sometimes the guidelines fall into political science rather than medical science. We've got to do a better job. So the practice guidelines from the American Society of Interventional Pain Physicians look at the available evidence, the clinical problem, the clinical experience with the subject procedure, and the members of the board have to make a conflict of interest statement to try to limit bias. And we look primarily at therapeutic interventions. Improperly evaluated diagnostic tests have been the source of bias in previous iterations by other societies and other circumstances. Sometimes the criticism has been that the trials are not good enough or that the effect sizes are too small, and guidelines do not help in decision-making. That's been some of the criticisms against guidelines. For example, the American Pain Physician created guidelines for spinal pain, but that was based on two documents by two individuals, with one physician who was not a pain or interventional physician and a marriage and family therapist making the recommendations. In the American Society of Anesthesiologists and the American Society of Regional Anesthesia, there were no published systematic reviews associated with those guidelines. So I believe that evidence-based medicine is the future for determining not only the utilization, the satisfactory implementation of approaches for managing our patients' pain, but also the cost effectiveness of doing so by eliminating bias and by eliminating the conflict of interest. So what are the guidelines state through ACIP? Again, this went through iterations in 2013 and 2021. It's a systematic review of the existence evidence created by a panel of experts, which is a very transparent and reproducible process, looking at the quality of evidence and revised as appropriate. In the case of the ACIP guidelines, we do revise them every 6 or 7 years or so. And what do we find? My slides are frozen. Oh, okay. So what do we find is that the evidence is good and fair for the use of spinal cord stimulation for failed back surgery syndrome, and it's limited evidence for the use of intrathecal drug delivery systems, meaning the implantation of a pump to deliver opioids or muscle relaxants or a combination thereof. So implantables have good and fair evidence when used for failed back surgery syndrome and also now for complex regional pain syndrome. The interventions, the summary of evidence for the lumbar spine is that the evidence is good and fair for diagnostic and therapeutic facet joint blocks of the nerves, radio frequency, diagnostic sacroiliac joint injections, cooled radio frequency, caudal lumbar epidural injections, and transforaminal injections for radicular type pain, especially for disc herniations, the use of caudals and lumbar epidural steroid injections for discogenic or axial pain, evidence is good and fair. The use of caudal steroid injections for failed back surgery syndrome, spinal stenosis, therapeutic medial branch blocks, percutaneous adhesiolysis, and lumbar provocation discography. So this is a summary of all the evidence, the synthesis of all the evidence, and we reviewed literally thousands of scientific documents to come to this conclusion. The evidence is limited or non-existent, however, for diagnostic or selective nerve root blocks. For the use of transforaminal injections for axial or discogenic pain, the use of transforaminal injections for failed back surgery syndrome, the use of pulsed radio frequency, intra-articular facet joint.
So we lost you, Kenneth. And the picture froze. Is anyone can hear me? All right, okay. So I just, you know, I was just interrupted to see. So thank you. I cannot see you, Kenneth. As you finish, it's frozen, we lost him. Okay. I think it was excellent overview of what's happening in on the other side of the pond in terms of intervention in pain medicine, and looking from the wide spectrum from simple intervention to the most complex interventions. I would like to have some questions for Kenneth in terms how it works and